Hi there. In this tutorial, I'm going to demonstrate some simple particle setups to create the two sets of fireworks that you can see being demonstrated on the screen now. So we've got a sort of Roman candle type effect down at the bottom, and we've got obviously some mortar effects, which is obviously the biggest part of the demonstration, where it fires a mortar up into the air and then it explodes. And I'll show you just some quick ways to set all those things up. I rendered this in EV. You could equally do it in cycles, but obviously will tend to be a longer render if you do it in cycles. And I think EV is more than satisfactory for a relatively straightforward render like this. If you enjoy these tutorials, don't forget to click like and subscribe. Feel free to comment or ask questions or even dislike the video. And if you don't like the video, I'd be very interested to see what the issues you spotted were so that I can improve going forward. If you're a Patreon supporter, I do upload these files for any use available to my Patreon supporters, and I upload tutorials quite regularly. So let's start the tutorial. So to begin with, let's just work on those Roman candle type effects. That's what they're called in the UK, at least. I think peony might be another term for them. So obviously I enclosed the emitters of the particles in some meshes, some tubes, to make them look more like they might look in real life. The main thing we're going to focus on here is the particle systems. So I'm just going to create a mesh circle, go into edit mode, and then just press F to fill that. So it's just a simple plane. And before we go any further, I need to create the firework effects themselves, the spheres. So I'm just going to add an icosphere. We'll just move that over here for the moment. I'll set it to smooth shading, doesn't matter too much. And we'll add a new material to that, and we'll call this something like glow blue. And I'm going to change the principled shader to an emission shader. And obviously I'll give this quite bright blue color. And I used a strength of about 5, and we'll also name the icosphere glow sphere blue, something like that. And then I'm going to duplicate it and perhaps duplicate those. And obviously what I'm going to do is name each one a different color. So we'll make that one red, that one we'll make green, yellow. Now they've all got the same material on at the moment. So before we change it, we need to just click this little number here, which indicates that material is used on 4 different objects at the moment. So we click it and it becomes unique. We'll change the name just so we know what it is. We'll make that one red, and then obviously just change this to red down here, and then do the same on the others. And I'm going to make another one. We'll take our yellow sphere for that, and we'll rename that one Sparks. You can do something a bit more advanced if you're using cycles, and we can actually change the color of them as they're being emitted, but that's not supported in EV, so I'm not going to worry too much about it. And we'll just make that a sort of orangey color, and we'll make it a bit darker. So we'll just make that only a strength of 1 on there. I'm then going to take these 4 and move them to a new collection, which is the glow spheres collection. And we'll just move these over here out of the way. So now we're ready to continue with the firework emitter. So the best thing to do at this point is to decide how long your animation is going to be. I'm going to set it to 500, which is what I had mine set to, which is about 20 seconds or so, depending on the frame rate at which you render. So we'll go to particle systems. So for a change, we're not using geometry nodes. We'll also change the name of this from circle to RC emitter. And we'll click the plus to give us a particle system. And we'll name this something like the RC parts. And we'll name it there as well. And I made it emit about 25 particles. Put a random seed selection on there. You can see it's starting to emit particles already. Purely because if you want multiples, then you want them to be in a different place. You don't want them necessarily to be all aligned. If you do want them to be aligned, just set the seed to the same number, which could be 0. Seed just sets the starting point for the pseudo random that the computer uses. I want them to start on frame 1, and I want them to run for the whole animation, so we'll set the end to 500. I want the particles to exist for, let's say, 125 frames, and we'll see if that's too long, too short. But I will give them a certain randomness to the particle lifetime, so some of them will be about 25% shorter than that. Now, if we look at the cache, we're going to want to use this because it's always worth baking your animation, your particle animation, once you've set it all up. And that way you don't get in any odd effects if you start playing from anything other than frame 1. Typically it will create the cache as you play, but I have found a few strange things, especially when you come to render, if you don't bake. But we don't need to bake yet. So then we come to velocity. So if I click play at the moment, you can see it's sort of emitting the particles up, and then they're just falling down under the effect of gravity. We want them to be affected by gravity, but obviously we want them to be emitted a little bit faster than that. So at the moment it's emitting from the normal, which is clearly pointing up here. If they just shoot straight down, then you just need to turn it over. And I used a normal velocity of about 30 meters per second. So you can now see they get fired up and then they start falling down. So that's sort of okay. They're a little small at the moment. So if we open physics up, you can play with the mass of them. For these ones, I found 1 kilogram was fine. I did add a little bit of Brownian motion, which just adds a little bit of randomness to their overall movement and makes them a little bit less artificial looking. So just 0.01 is all I put in there. And then under render, at the moment it's halo, which means it's a non-real particle, as it were. So we'll come into here and we'll say collection. And then a little bit further down, we can choose the collection, which is our glow spheres. And we want to say pick random. So it's just randomly picking from our collection of spheres which one to render as a particle. And I set the scale to 0.9. Let's see what that looks like in our case. That's sort of okay at the moment. That might be a little big for this particular version. Maybe we'll go for 0.75. And because we're emitting from the normal, you'll notice if I rotate this, they'll start emit in that direction. I think we'll go a little smaller again. We'll go for 0.5. So if we come up to here and we change to EV now, I'll set the background to simple black and we'll go to rendered view. And you can see we've got the glowing spheres being emitted. If we're using EV, what we will want to do is turn on bloom as well, and that makes it look an awful lot better. You can see there they all are over there. So that's getting there. It's not quite what we want yet. You can play around with some of the parameters under bloom to make the bloom effect bigger or smaller. And obviously you can change the brightness of the spheres themselves, which will also affect how much of a bloom effect there is around the spheres, this sort of foggy glow effect. For some of the camera shots I did for the demo, I did use motion blur, although it won't show so much in the viewport, but for others I didn't. If the camera's moving, motion blur doesn't work so well in EV. For a still camera, it's fairly fine. But we do need another particle system to make this look a little better. So I'll leave it rendering as we're going, and we'll come back to our particle system. We'll add a new one and we'll call this RC Sparks. And you can see that's where our little sphere is there, and it's busily just dropping particles. So I went for about 5,000. Again, I want it to go from frame one all the way up to the last frame, which is frame 500. I only had a lifetime of about 100, and we'll see if that's satisfactory. And I had about 0.75 for the randomness. So a lot of variation in how long the particles lasted before they disappeared. By the way, by default, both of these particle systems will be set to emit from faces, which is, if you're doing it the way I'm doing it, that's what you'll want to do. Whether you use random or jittered isn't going to make too much difference. And then under velocity, again, 30 meters per second, and we'll start getting them being emitted up. Bear in mind, it's going straight up at the moment, so it won't be really creating a curve. If I do an X rotation at 45 degrees, now you can see that's probably a bit extreme. So just 10 degrees rotation, and you can see we're getting a bit of a curve being developed. And our big glowy particles are being emitted with them. So I put a lot more Brownian on these as they're tiny little sparks. So I put something like 0.25 on these. You may just be able to make out it's a little bit more randomness into the particles, though not a vast amount. And then I came down here, and this time I'm going to select object, and the object is going to be sparks. So if I turn off the overlay, you can now see we've got these little sparks, and where they're close to the glow spheres, they're actually being illuminated, which is why they're looking the way they are. It doesn't look quite like that if you stop it. You can see them better because they are emitting light. It's just to do with the way that the viewport works in EV, but it's quite fun. And I used a scale of about 0.15. Depends on what distance you're going to view them from. Perhaps I'll go a little smaller, I'll go for 0.1. And then a high scale randomness. So that just means they're all going to be different sizes, essentially. So you can see they're not all the same size there. And then very simply, I've removed the rotation there. I'm just going to duplicate it. And I'll do another one there. Rotate that one on the Y minus 15 degrees. Rotate that one on Y minus 10, that one plus 10, and that one plus 15. At the moment, they've all got the same particle system, literally the same particle system. And for the sparks, that doesn't really matter. But what it does mean, as you can see, they all emit the same color particle at the same time because it's using the same seed. If you want that, then that's it, you're done. If, however, you'd like them to be different, you need to select each emitter in turn. So we've got our first one. If we go to the emitter 001 here, select the RC particles one, you notice it's got the 4 on there, click that, and that now becomes unique, and we can now change the seed. And then we can do the same to the next one. Just change it to any other number, it doesn't matter really what the number is. And now you can see they've all got their own randomness, so sometimes they'll emit the same color and sometimes they won't. So that's how we can do what I call the Roman candles, or I think it's also called peonies. I think that looks quite fair. And now for the slightly more involved one, which is the mortars. So I'm just going to put those Roman candles into their own little collection, get them out of the way. And I'm going to add a cylinder, put that here. And I'm going to go into edit mode, select the top face and press I. And then that just allows me to inset a face. Go into wireframe mode, we'll come out of perspective view. E, click G, Z, and we'll just lower that down to somewhere about there. So I'm making literally a cylinder, a hollow cylinder. Worth quickly checking the face orientation. So we want to see that that's all blue, which it is, so that's fine. You notice the underside of these is red, which is where it should be, the normal's upward. And that's our mortar launcher. So I'm now gonna add another icosphere, and I'm gonna put that coincident with my launcher there. Obviously you can put the 3D cursor in the right place to start with, and then they'll appear on top of each other. But I'm going to make it slightly smaller than the inside of that tube. I'm going to set it to shade smooth, doesn't really matter that much. But it's inside my tube, it's the important thing. Not quite at the bottom, and that's fine. So this is going to be the mortar shell that gets fired up and explodes, or appears to explode at least. So now I'm going to select my launcher, just change the name of that other one to mortar. I select my launcher, go up to object under rigid body, and say add passive. And then I'm going to select the other object, the mortar itself, and say object, rigid body, add passive. Now let's see what happens when I just click play. Absolutely nothing at the moment. And what might happen is it might just fire straight out of the tube. But let's have a look at the tube under our physics properties. And you notice it's a convex hull at the moment. Because of the way we're using it, we need to use the more complex option, which is mesh. It's also worth applying scale to everything in there. Looks like I accidentally set the sphere to passive, should have been set to active. The cylinder needs to be passive, the sphere needs to be active. And we can even set it to sphere, which will just make it a little better. So there we can see at the moment, it simply falls to the bottom. Sometimes it might fire out, but falling to the bottom is fine. That just shows that it's now got physics properties on it and they're both interacting. Strictly, you don't need physics properties on this, so you can leave them on there or not. It will just help if there's any misalignments of anything. So now I'm going to decide when my mortar is going to be fired. So we're going to fire this mortar at, say, frame 50. So that's about 2 seconds into the animation. And at the moment, it's not doing anything. So I'm going to press I, which has recorded all of the parameters, location, rotation, etc., for that mortar. But at the moment, they're pretty much being ignored, the keyframes, because I haven't clicked this. So make sure that you then click animated here. So you now see it's just fixed. And what I want to do is go to, say, frame 60. So that's only 10 frames later, and GZ, I'm just moving that sphere up a bit. Doesn't matter too much. The amount you move it is going to affect how fast it's fired out of the tube. So I'm going to press I again. I am going to click those keyframes actually, and just say interpolation mode linear. So instead of being Bezier where it slowly speeds up and then slows down, this is just going to be suddenly accelerated to max speed till it reaches the position of the second keyframe. So if we watch what happens, it just suddenly moves up at the rate that it needs to have it complete in 10 frames. So just under half a second, really. So how do we make it then carry on moving under the effect of gravity? Well, the simple thing we can do is animate the animated checkbox here. So I'm going to go to frame 59 and press I while hovering over that checkbox. Then go forward to frame 60, uncheck it, and animated again. So that essentially that animated checkbox is being turned off right at the point that it's reaching that position. We look at it now, and you can see it gets fired up, and then it slowly slows down and comes back under the force of gravity. So we can then have a look, see if that's fast enough, possibly not. So if we come back to keyframe 60 and raise that up quite a bit, I won't go too far. I'll have these explode quite low. I'm going to Alt I and delete that keyframe. Sometimes when the cache has been baked, it can be a bit unwilling to cooperate. There we go. I just went back to the beginning of the animation to make it rebake the cache. So we'll have it go up to there and then keyframe the position. Still the same frame. Looks like we lost the turning off animated effect there. So we need to just unclick that and re-keyframe that one. And there you go. That's going quite high. And there's some things we can do to control that over and above changing the amount. So you can see changing the height at which it works will affect how high things will go. But you'll also notice it stopped moving. And the reason for that is because the size of the cache for the rigid body world. So if we come to the scene properties, you can see the rigid body world is there. And if we come down and look at cache, it's only 250 frames. So we'll set that to 500 frames. And you can just about see our mortar going up there, going very, very high, way too high, really. But it's slowing down, so it will reach an apex and then actually start falling back again. So you can see it gets there at about frame 400. But we can now play around with some of the properties. So if we go back to the physics properties for our mortar, I left it at about 1 kilogram, but I put some damping on. So under dynamic, I put it up to about 0.5. Let's see what that does. So that will slow any velocity that it's got over time. And there you go, you can see the damping has now made it cease rising much more quickly. It's like air resistance, if you like. And you can see it's slowly accelerating due to the acceleration of gravity. We're not too worried about where it gets to when it falls. But if we look, we can see it's about a frame 150, it starts to fall back. So that's a number to remember. So that's the launching part of our mortar. The next thing is the particle system. So we've gone to particle systems here and we'll add a particle system. And let's do the launch sparks to start with. So I did a lot for this. So I did about 25,000 particles and I want it to start at the same frame as my mortar starts to launch. So that is about frame 60. So we'll put 60 there. And I want them to stop at about the frame that the explosion happens. So if we look at what's happening, if we say frame 175, so let's end at frame 175. The lifetime we may need to play with, but quite a bit shorter. We'll just try a lifetime of 10 and something like 0.7, 0.8 for the lifetime randomness. The only thing I changed here was I turned off even distribution, so it was a bit more random, but it doesn't matter too much. So you can just about see it's producing some particles that are catching up with it there. You may get some effects like this, but we'll do what we can to improve that. This is to do with the rate at which the particles are being emitted and the rate at which the mortar is moving. I'm going to say zero for the normal, so they're not actually going to be fired out of the mortar at all. They're just going to fall out of it. It sort of looks like they're coming in a bit late at the moment. So I think we'll have the particles start more like frame 50. That's a little better. You can see where the mortar is moving at its fastest. That's when we have the most significant of this, and you may not be able to eliminate that completely, but you can add some object velocity, which will basically add some movement to the particles rather than them just falling based on how fast the object itself is moving. So let's try 0.1 and we'll randomize that a bit as well. And that's improved it maybe a little. It's sort of added a certain amount of self-movement to the particles, which sort of scrambles them a bit. We could even try turning that up. That's actually quite a bit better. But what I did do is add quite a bit of Brownian motion, just to again give them some of their own movement. So I'll put 0.25 of Brownian on there. Won't be that visible yet. And then under render, we're going to say object and we're going to select our sparks again. And we'll try 0.25 for the scale and see what that's like. I'll just turn off the overlay. That might actually be a bit too big, so let's go to 0.1, maybe even 0.05. We don't want these sparks to be that visible, it's just supposed to be a little clue that something's just been fired out. Again, you have to bear in mind this is just the viewport, so things look slightly different when you render. I think that'll do for now. And then we need to add our explosion at the end. So we know we've said our explosion is going to be at frame 175, so we're going to add another particle system. And we'll go for something like 100 particles. We'll do them all at frame 175. That's where it reaches the apex, and the end 175. So they all come out at the same time. We'll give them a longer lifetime. We'll try 150, see what that's like. But we'll give them a fair bit of randomness on the life, so about 30% there. And a velocity, we'll give them 30 meters a second again. You can add a little bit of Brownian, so let's put 0.1 in there. That might give them some extra motion. And if we want them all to be the same color, then we can just select render an object and select one of our glowing spheres. So let's say the red one. So let's see what we've got so far. And there it is. They're a little small, I think, at the moment, which is why they're flickering the way they are. So let's try a scale of 3. And it may be the frame 175 is a bit late, actually. Yeah, I think it's more like frame 150. So let's go back to our sparks. Let's stop those at about 150. And our mortar will do at 150 as well. And I can already see that that scale is a little large. So we'll go for a scale of 1. And there you go. And if you wanted a multicolored explosion, obviously this is the ground here, so they've possibly got a slightly long lifetime as well. So let's drop that to 100. But if we want a multicolored one, then instead of object here, we can say collection, and we can select the glow spheres collection. Make sure you select pick random, and off it goes and explodes. That's the basics of how you create those fireworks. But obviously you might want to do more than one, and you might want to change when particularly the mortars shoot up. There's a slight bit of extra complication to do that. So I've opened a new window up there, but we'll go to the start. So I want to select my object here. What if I just want to move it to somewhere slightly different? I might even want to angle it, but let's just say I want to move it on the x-axis. So I've done that, that's fine. And you notice as soon as I click play, the arcosphere came back here. And the reason for that is because here I recorded all parameters about the position, scale, rotation, etc. for that object. So every time I copy it and make a duplicate, they're all going to come back to that position, but I can change that. So if I go to the dope sheet, here is all the keyframes that were set. And the only keyframe that I want it to remember, in the old days, you would have been able to just record, very easily record just the Z axis for keyframing. It's not quite so straightforward anymore. So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to turn off this little tick box for X and Y location. Don't care about anything else, but X and Y location for this object is now turned off. So let's just check it's still working. You can see it did. So now I'm going to select my launcher and the mortar itself, move them over here. And click play, and you notice it stayed there, and yet it's still fired out. So now, having deselected the animation for X and Y, I can create duplicates and put them in a different place, and they should, at the moment, they'll all be synchronized, but they should, as you see, they all just fired off like that. So let's say this middle one, which was the first one we did, which is this mortar, we want to be the multicolored one, but we want that one to fire later. So if we collapse all of these, A twice, just to deselect everything. And then I'm going to box select the parameters for just that mortar, which is our first one. And then I'm going to move them, let's say something like that. Now the particle systems, I haven't retimed yet. But I'll move them up to 70 so it's nice and straightforward. But let's see what happens. So it's that central one. You can see it fired after the others. But it still triggers at the same time. So we want it to fire probably, say, frame 175 now, which is where we started, I think. Let's make sure that we make the launch sparks particles unique for that one. Remember, that's important if you want them to work at a different time. And the mortar explode unique. We'll then change start point for those particles to be 70, which is roughly where that one starts, and the end point to be 175. And then the explosion, 175. It updates the end automatically for you if you do it that way. And then I'm going to go to my other mortars, both of which share the same particle system, and we'll go back to object, and it's already defaulted to the red one. So if we have a look at what that now looks like, you can see we get the red ones fire, and then we've got the multicolored one. Or we could just change it to an object again, but this time we'll go for blue perhaps. And the good thing with Eevee, it's all pretty much real time. And it doesn't take long to render at all. It was rendering at less than a second per frame for me. And that's all there is to it. So I hope you enjoyed that tutorial. If you did, let me know. Feel free to add any comments or questions below this video. I will share the original file with my Patreon supporters as always. And hopefully you might find some use for this for the 4th of July perhaps. Otherwise, I will see you in the next tutorial. Thanks a lot.
Floating here, where the quiet never ends, in starlight's glow, where my heart contends, the constellations, they know me by name. Each night they return, each ever the same. If I could converse with the moon's pale beam, I'd share my solitude, speak my dream. In the void of space, so vast and still, where silence reigns and time does spill, on this lonely sphere I call my home. Amongst the stars I am alone. If I were a traveler across the cosmic sea, I'd chart my course by galaxy. In this expanse where the winds whisper low and the sun's just a dot with a faint gentle glow, sky's painted hues not known to man's eye, here I wander and gaze beneath the alien sky. Maybe someday a soul will pass by in their ship made of dreams, sailing the sky. Stars my compass on this strange terrain, songs of solitude my only refrain. Through the silence my spirit roams free, in the vastness, these darkened land, oh, why and then.